Welcome to the next teaching unit in the chapter PV system design, which will deal with the sizing of the inverter. In this teaching unit, we will deal with the question of how exactly to size an inverter. To begin with, let's take a look at the criteria that need to be taken into account. First of all, an inverter has a certain rated power. This corresponds to the maximum AC output power that the inverter can deliver. Next, an inverter has a maximum permissible input DC voltage, which must never be exceeded when the system is in operation. This is the only criteria that can lead to the destruction of the inverter if it is incorrectly sized. In addition, there is a certain input voltage range in which the MPP tracker of the inverter can find and set the MPP of a string. The MPP of the solar generator should be within this voltage range in all operating conditions. Usually, the first step is to determine the desired power of the inverter. You might ask yourself what there is to determine. Couldn't you simply choose the inverter power as large as the power of the solar generator? Basically, you won't do anything wrong if you do exactly that. However, in practice, it is common to size the inverter somewhat smaller than the solar generator. The reason for this are mainly economic considerations. Since the cost of the inverter increases with its rated power, while the yield losses are very small if it is undersized. Let us first consider the rated power of a PV module. This always refers to standard test conditions, mainly an irradiance of 1000 watt per square meter and a module temperature of 25 degrees Celsius. However, these conditions hardly ever occur in normal operation, since the solar modules heat up by 20 to 45 degrees Celsius at such high irradiance, depending on the installation situation. This can be seen clearly in the diagram shown here for a rooftop installation in Cologne. Due to the heating of the solar modules, their performance drops significantly compared to STC conditions. When the temperature rises by 10 degrees Celsius, the output of an average silicon module decreases by around 5%. So, if the module temperature is at moderate 45 degrees Celsius instead of 25 degrees Celsius, we must already assume a 10% lower output. Due to the correlation just explained, the nominal power is very rarely reached during normal operation of a PV module. The largest share of the annual energy yield is therefore generated at lower PV outputs. Let us again consider the example of a rooftop system in Cologne with an optimal tilt angle. Here, about 97% of the annual energy yield is generated at system outputs below the nominal output. You can never destroy the inverter by undersizing it. The inverter will only be loaded more often with its nominal power, and the PV power exceeding this will be derated. The inverter does not switch off when the power is too high, but only reduces the output power to its nominal power. This is also referred to as clipping. Clipping causes losses compared to the theoretical possible yield of the PV generator, but the essential part of the energy can be used. The ratio of the nominal power of the solar generator to the inverter is also called the DC to AC ratio. A DC to AC ratio greater than 1 corresponds to an undersized inverter, and a DC to AC ratio smaller than 1 corresponds to an oversized inverter. But which DC to AC ratio is optimal? This question cannot be answered in general because the answer depends on the temperature and the irradiation conditions at the location, as well as on the orientation and the inclination of the modules. Let's take a look at this using the example of a plant in Cologne, Germany, which is oriented to the south and has an optimal tilt angle of 33 degrees. Here we plot the yield losses that result from clipping for different DC to AC ratios. We can see that even with a DC to AC ratio of 0.8, meaning a heavily oversized inverter, there's still a little loss due to clipping. The reason for this is that high direct irradiance is most frequently incident on the modules due to the steep tilt. At these irradiance levels, the modules can deliver up to 130% of the nominal power. When dimensioning the inverter, one should try to limit the yield losses due to undersizing to 1 or better 0.5%. For the plant considered here, this means a maximum DC to AC ratio of approximately 1.1. For a less steeply inclined plant with 10 degree inclination, however, the inverter can also be sized significantly smaller since very high irradiance levels occur less frequently due to the lower inclination. In this case, a maximum DC to AC ratio of 1.25 would still be okay. This situation is even more extreme with an east-west oriented plant with 10% inclination angle. Here, the DC to AC ratio can even be up to 1.3. In principle, an inverter can of course also be oversized. However, this only makes sense in very few cases, namely when a very high irradiance with simultaneously low temperatures can be expected for a significant time of the year. Examples of such a case are very irradiation-rich areas at high altitudes, since the modules heat up only slightly here due to the moderate temperatures despite high irradiance. Shown here are the yield losses of a system in Vallenar, which is located in the Atacama Desert in Chile. The annual irradiation here is 1950 kilowatt hours per square meter and the average temperature is 12 degrees Celsius. For comparison, in Cologne, the annual irradiation is 1030 kilowatt hours per square meter with a similar average temperature. With an optimal inclination of the modules, the design factor here should not exceed 1, so the inverter should not be undersized in any case. The situation is different for locations with high radiation but also high temperatures. As an example, here you can see the yield losses for a plant in Phoenix, USA. The annual irradiation of 2100 kilowatt hours per square meter is a bit higher than in Vallenar, but the temperature of 24 degrees Celsius is significantly higher. As a result, high PV outputs occur less frequently and the design factor can be selected similar to the one for a system in Cologne. Whether an inverter with the appropriate rated power is actually suitable, however, now also depends on the voltages occurring at the generator. Let us first consider the maximum input voltage of the inverter. As just briefly mentioned, this voltage must never be exceeded during normal operation. But why is this so? Let's take another look at the schematic structure of an inverter. Every solar inverter has a large capacitor, the so-called DC link. This capacitor is the interface between the continuous energy flow of the solar generator and the alternating energy flow of the AC grid. Here, so-called electrolytic capacitors are usually used, which offer a large capacity on a very small space. In electrolytic capacitors, one of the internal capacitor plates consists of a liquid electrolyte. The maximum input voltage of the inverter usually corresponds to the nominal voltage of this electrolytic capacitor. If the inverter is now applied with an overvoltage, flashovers can occur between the plates of this capacitor. This results in a very large short circuit current and a corresponding strong local temperature increase. This again causes the electrolyte to evaporate and the inverter dies with a loud bang when the vapor escapes. Of course, the remaining power electronics of the inverter are also designed for a certain maximum voltage, and these components are also destroyed if the voltage is exceeded. We must therefore ask ourselves under which circumstances the maximum possible DC voltage occurs at the solar generator. For this purpose, let us once again visualize the characteristic curve of a solar module. The highest possible voltage is the open circuit voltage. This voltage is present, for example, when the inverter cannot feed into the public grid due to a power failure. We have also learned that the open circuit voltage is not constant, but changes with both the cell temperature and the irradiance. In general, the lower the cell temperature and the higher the irradiance, the higher the open circuit voltage of the solar generator. The solar generator therefore reaches the maximum pulse voltage during a power failure on a very cold, very sunny day around midday. The inverter must be prepared for this extreme case. To calculate the highest possible open circuit voltage, we can use the equation which we have already learned in this context. But what is the coldest temperature? And can the solar module even get the maximum irradiance at these extremely low temperatures? This mainly depends on the location and the orientation and the inclination of the solar modules. If the modules are installed with a steep tilt angle, high irradiance at low temperature is definitely possible in winter with well back ventilated modules. However, due to the logarithmic dependency, the irradiance has a much smaller overall effect on the voltage than the temperature. Thus, we assume an irradiance of 1000 watt per square meter for the calculation of the highest open circuit voltage. In the equation for the open circuit voltage, the last term is therefore eliminated. For the temperature, a minimum temperature of minus 10 degrees is usually assumed for a plant in Germany. Depending on the location, however, lower temperature are also possible. For a plant in Helsinki, in the north of Europe, a temperature of minus 20 degrees Celsius should be expected. In order to calculate the highest expected open circuit voltage for a specific solar module, we need the open circuit voltage at STC conditions as well as the temperature coefficient beta. Both values can be found in the data sheet of a solar module. In practice, however, several modules are connected in series, in a string. The open circuit voltage of the solar generator is then equal to the number of solar modules connected in series multiplied by the open circuit voltage for one module. Thus, the maximum permissible input voltage of the inverter must be at least be larger than this value. Conversely, we can also calculate the maximum allowed number of modules that can be connected together in a string for a particular inverter. This value is of course always rounded down to the nearest whole number. It may then be necessary to leave out one or even more modules in order to be able to use a particular inverter. The next sizing condition we will deal with is the MPP tracking range of the inverter. If possible, the inverter should be able to set the optimal operating point at the generator even in extreme situations, that is, at very high or at very low MPP voltages. In contrast to the last criterion, however, the inverter will not be damaged if the generator voltage should be somewhat higher or lower, since the MPP voltage is in vegetably always lower than the open circuit voltage. If the MPP voltage range is exceeded, the generator is simply no longer operated at MPP, and a small reduction in yield must be expected. If we also take into account that the solar modules heat up by 20 to 45 degrees Celsius during normal operation, it basically makes no sense to use the upper voltage limit of the MPP tracker as a design limit. So let's take a look at the lower voltage limit and ask ourselves when the lowest MPP voltage of the generator can be expected. This occurs in exactly the opposite case to the situation just considered. The smallest voltage results at very high temperatures with simultaneously very low irradiance. The highest module temperature to be expected also depends on the location, of course. For systems in Germany, 70 degrees Celsius are assumed, which can realistically be reached, especially in poorly ventilated roof-mounted or in-roof systems. However, this maximum temperature will almost never occur together with a very low irradiation or irradiance, since the high module temperature is caused by high direct irradiance. In addition, the irradiance has only a comparatively small influence on the voltage. Therefore, we assume a module temperature of 70 degrees Celsius and an irradiance of 1000 watt per square meter for the calculation of the maximum MPP voltage. In order to calculate the lowest expected MPP voltage for a specific solar module, we actually need the temperature coefficient of the MPP voltage. In most cases, however, this cannot be found in the data sheet. As an approximation, we can use the temperature coefficient of the open circuit voltage. From the minimum MPP module voltage, the minimum string voltage in the MPP can be calculated as before. If we want to calculate how many modules have to be connected in series to stay within the MPP range of the inverter, we calculate the coefficient of the module voltage in the MPP and the minimum MPP voltage of the inverter. The number of modules must be larger than this coefficient. If you connect too few modules in series, the inverter will not be damaged. However, you have to expect that especially in the warmer summer months, the inverter can no longer operate the solar modules at the MPP, and you have to accept higher yield losses. In practice, this should of course be avoided, and a sufficient number of solar modules should always be connected together in one string. Let's summarize this teaching unit. We've learned about three essential criteria for sizing the inverter. The inverter's rated power should be at least equal to the generator's rated power divided by the system-specific DC to AC ratio. The maximum input voltage of the inverter should never be exceeded. This is based on the generator open circuit voltage at the lowest expected temperature. The minimum MPP voltage of the inverter should be higher than the lowest expected MPP voltage of the generator. The highest expected module temperature is assumed here. I thank you for your attention.